We should remember this. Let's do that again. Hi, I'm Angela Gunder. I'm one of the co-chairs of OLC Live, coming to you from Orlando, Florida, at the Online Learning Consortium's fall conference, OLC Accelerate, which starts tomorrow. And this is...
I am Clark Shaw Nelson and co-host of OLC Live here.
And we're all about bringing people together around topics that we're passionate about and that we think will be impactful to teaching and learning, particularly access and impact within education. And we have a week of programming where we're going to be looking at all sorts of things related to the future of education. The future is now. And today we thought that we would actually kick it off with looking at the global conversation around open. And there are a lot of buzzwords related to open, and there are a lot of different avenues and approaches to coming into open. So we thought it would be really compelling to have leading experts, thought leaders, change agents from around the globe talk to us about what they see in their particular context and help us to make extensions to the work that we're doing in our own context. We've been to Asia, we've been to Africa already, and now we're heading to Europe. And the way that this works is that we're going to have two provocations from our two invited speakers today. They're going to give you a lot to think about and digest. And after they're finished speaking, we will attempt to multitask. We know that multitasking is not a real thing, but we're going to do the best that we can. And what we're going to do is engage in an activity on a collaborative worksheet. And I'm going to pop that into the chat right now. I'll probably do that several times throughout the course of the day. You can follow along on here. And there are a series of questions that we have that we're going to engage in answering. And as part of answering those questions, you will by default become a co-author on a white paper that we are going to produce as a synthesis of this worksheet that we're working on together. So I invite you to really think deeply about how these two provocations challenge you, inspire you, and ways that you might bring that work back to your community, or ways that you're already doing that work. And these talks underscore the things that are already happening in your context. And in addition to that, if there are questions or ideas that you want to add to this, and you'll see me, I'll probably do it based on our two speakers, what they say, I might change or add some questions there too. You can do that as well. This is, it's open. You saw what I did there. There is one last question on the document that I want to make sure that you do try to hit, because it's key to the synthesis of this piece that we're working on. And it's, how do you personally define openness? So I would invite you to definitely take a little bit of time either during this session, or if you want to come back to the document later, if you want to share it with a colleague and maybe share a cup of coffee and have a discussion about some of the questions that are up here too. It's also a great way to connect around the resources that both of our speakers have placed on the document. So we invite you to spend some time and really sink in to the materials and the resources that they've presented here. And we invite you to share resources too within the chat that you might think of as they talk. So that was a lot of chatting. I'm going to turn it over to our first speaker. Frank de Lengen is joining us from the Open University of the Netherlands, and he is the Chief of Strategy and General Management there. And he's going to talk about different kinds of openness. So without any further ado, I turn it over to you, Frank.
Unmute.
Oh, and you have to unmute.
Yeah, I was just telling you all that I'm not very experienced in these kind of conferences, so I hope everything goes okay. But without further ado, let's go on. My name is Frank Lange. I'm the chair in Strategy and General Management, and in that sense, I'm already, I think, 10 years the strange duck on the street, or perhaps the elephant in the room, because my involvement with openness started with Fred Mulder. Probably a lot of you know him, who was then a rector of the Open University. And he said, we're going to give away everything, all our courses, all our materials, we're going to give it away because openness is the new black, so to speak. And the people at the Open University asked him, if you're going to give away all our courseware, who is going to pay our mortgages, who is going to pay our salaries, because when everything is open, there is no reason for students to earn to pay the Open University a fee. But it never got that far, but it made me as an business economist interested in what are sustainable models for openness, especially when you look into, and I've seen a lot of European projects, and to be rather skeptical, openness is fine, but when the subsidy leaves, when the money leaves the room, everything starts falling to is disappearing, is falling down. So can I move the sheets myself, or yeah, I don't want to go into openness as a concept too much, because I also saw that Maren is going to talk about it a little bit, and I think the other people also did, but did and gonna do. But I think openness started with the open universities, which Fred Mulder called the classical openness, in which entry is free, but nothing else is, in the sense of free of costs, free of fees. We moved on to open educational resources, and I think the unique thing of this is in the whole field of openness, open educational resources are the only one which are also available for reuse and remix, because open universities do courses, MOOCs are not available for reuse and remix unless you put it in a program as it is. And now what I see is that a lot of, especially the MOOC platforms, are moving on to SPOCs, which are small courses which are adapted for special users and for which you have to pay, for which you can get a degree, but you have to pay for the degree. And from my point of view, we are back to the open universities, because the courses and everything are behind a paywall. Well, having said that, we had a discussion within the European Union, and there is in Sevilla is a very nice organization, which the name I'm missing at the moment, but I did put the link in the Google documents, and they did some research on dimensions of openness, and they defined six internal essential dimensions, starting with content and access, but we already talked about that because that's the regular open dimension. But I also think that an institution should have an open pedagogy, the recognition between institutions should be better organized, so if you do an course with the Open University of the UK, you should combine it with other institutions. Collaboration, research, well, you can read it up. What was especially new is that they said an organization to become an open organization, openness should be part of the strategy. The technology should be supporting, but we know that. But also we have to do something about an European framework of quality for open courseware, open resources. And institutions should, the boards of the institutions should take the leadership in the open movement. And only when you have the combination of these components, you can contribute to the open movement in Europe. So one of the questions you state is, how can we become more open as an institution, as an organization? And this report tries to help you with giving these all these dimensions. Having said that, that would be the end of my talk originally. But talking with Angela, I realized that these are only the supply side, the providers of open education, because this is about institutions. MOOCs are about individuals putting up MOOCs, or institutions like Delft who do a lot of things, or Future Learn in the UK. But we never say anything about the people who learn using these kind of materials. Now, I did a case study on several institutions, and the purpose of the case study was supply oriented. So I was looking at what are the special characteristics of these, how try these organizations, how do they try to survive? And the funny thing is, the European MOOC platforms and Open Up Ed was my case. They try to survive by surfacing for the audio organizations, for the higher education institutions, would put the MOOCs with them, quality for learners, all kinds of those kinds of things. And the extent I think that they are providing these services, and the extent to which they are successful towards the learners is criticized because of the success of the commercial firms. And I have studied Lumen, and in Spain, in Barcelona, you got Humorock. I hope that I pronounce it rightly. But there is also something which I labeled Merlot 2. I did a study on Merlot with Gary, who gave me a lot of information, especially about Merlot 2, which is the extension of the community as a provider for other universities using the open materials generated in Merlot 1. To sustain the other universities in the community. But they all bridge the gap between the resources which are provided by several institutions, and we made all kinds of knowledge banks and things like that. But on the other hand, there are organizations, there are learners, and they, one way or another, they don't fit with the supply doesn't fit with what the users want, or the knowledge of the users how to reuse and remix the materials. And it's not that I'm skeptical about the intention of the providers, but the success of these kind of firms and these kind of initiatives like Merlot 2 show that there is some kind of gap. The funny thing is, and I hope Maren will talk more about Femtechnet, because I'm a huge supporter of, at least the people I've spoke from Femtechnet made me very enthusiastic about the way the self-organizing character of the network and things like that. But in Femtechnet and in Merlot, there is a lot of participation between the producers and the users. And in some cases, they are the same. So everything those networks produce is used. So if, for example, if Femtechnet would disappear in 5 years' time, it's because the people populating the network don't need it anymore. And as long as they think that they could need it, they have a need to produce things and share them, the network will self-organize and will exist. And the same is with Merlot. It's slightly different because there is an external partner who provides the technical support and things like that. But if a community in Merlot doesn't live anymore, they don't produce any more resources and things like that, they let diet and natural diet. So, well, that gave me, that made me thinking about what, and in that position, because I'm also being the chair, I'm also responsible for public management at the Open University. We're a small university. I went to look into openness in management, and there we have open innovation, but open innovation is only collaboration between a lot of firms in sharing their knowledge with the purpose to get an innovation, which is again the property of one or more of the firms, and sell it. So it's not really open in the educational definition of the word. And then I come to the letters of participation. Two phenomenon I saw, two things I saw, was the letter of participation in public management, and that starts very cynical with manipulation and therapy, where you say, well, this is good for you, but come and talk with me and I'll explain to you why this is good for you, which reminds me a lot of our bachelor master education. And the programs are set by the professionals and the students. We have all kinds of students participation committees and things like that, but in the end it's the professionals who say you have to do this or you have to do that. On the other end of the spectrum is citizen control. And that's very interesting because this letter is from Mrs. Arnstein, and I'll come back to that later, but she says control is participation is the transmission of power. So you can only be in control, a citizen can only be in control when they have the real power, the money and all the other things to influence a project. As long as you don't have the power, so as long as participation is just getting the ideas to the civil servants or to the politicians and not getting back the real control, it's still somewhere within partnership or consultation. Well, but that is rather, I don't see any institutions giving over the power of the university, for example, to the students. Well, we tried in the 60s, but I don't know if it really works. The other one is from the NHS, but you see it all over the health sector in the Netherlands and in Germany. But this I took from the NHS, and this is a little less ambitious, especially in the last two parts. This is about collaboration and devolving, and it's also, I think, closer to education, because it's about a specialist, your doctor, your things like that, and well, as a patient, you might be involved in getting better and you want to collaborate in a community of patients and things like that, but you can't replace your doctor and you can't take over all the power, perhaps in the future. But what I want to do and what I am thinking about now is to get these two letters of engagement and participation and look into the openness, because I think openness and that's the name of my presentation is a two-way street. So in regular programs I see a lot of information and perhaps some manipulation, and then I think about open universities, MOOCs and things like MOOC platforms and things like that. Whereas in commercial programs, I see a lot more of consulting and involving. And in the open sector, you talk about SPOCs, because you I'm also involved in an MBA here at the Open University, and when we try to sell special programs, you have to involve the students and you have to involve their employers and things like that, but you don't give away the power for organizing the whole education. Also, although we have this concept of all those little courses, 5 ECs, and people can build their own 2-year program, provided that in the end they have 120 ECs. So we give away a little bit of the power. We empower the students to make their own program, which is some kind of openness. But more interesting, I think, is how do communities work, and in the communities perhaps you have the real delegation of power, but at least you have the collaboration. So if you ask in your Google documents, what is how do you create a culture of openness, and I want to go beyond the European dimension of openness, but I want to create real openness in education, at this moment, but I'm not, it's not finished research. It's a thinking process in which I, which you triggered. So you're the one to blame. How do we involve learners, and are there possibilities to involve learners and to become a community of teachers and learners in a true open way, in the sense that we empower people to make their own choices and get their own programs back together. And I think if we can do that, we close the circle, because the original intention of the UNESCO with open educational resources was to empower people who are not in the position to participate in informal education, and to, for example, open educational resources in open ed in Africa, tries to empower low-income universities in low-income countries by providing materials which are cheaper than the regular American textbook. So for me, it's trying to come full circle, but I'm very interested to hear what other people think about it. Perhaps this is a crazy idea and I have to leave it, and but I don't know. Thank you.
Not too crazy. Thank you, Frank, and we're excited to dig into the conversation. I'm gonna turn it over to Marin now, who's gonna lead us in our next provocation. And we've gone over on time for the segments, but just know that we're gonna keep on broadcasting. We have a good buffer of time that we've built into this, so do not feel like you will be shortchanged of your time to collaborate, to ask Frank and Marin questions, and to dig into all of this richness. So without any further ado, I introduce you to Marin Deepwell, who's the Chief Executive of the Association for Learning Technology. Over to you, Marin.
Oh, hello, and hello everyone who is joining us here online. I'm excited to be virtually conferencing with you all. I usually just get to organize these events, which can be a lot more stressful than it looks. So kudos to the organizers who are making it all look so smooth. And thank you, Frank, for a really fascinating presentation. I really am so excited about the sort of efforts and the rigor that goes into the thinking around scaling up open education in Europe. So I'm going to try and share with you some sort of little provocations from my community, the Association for Learning Technology. And I hope that this will stimulate some discussion and will give you a sense of how to engage with this work if you're interested. So just to say, for those of you who haven't come across our body, we actually have quite a lot in common with OLC. So the association is a professional body for learning technologists, primarily in the UK, but we have members all across the world. And openness is one of our core values as an organization, and we believe in putting our values into practice, even if that can sometimes be a little harder than you think. So for us, openness as an organization helps us influence policymakers here in the UK, but also more widely in Europe and globally. Also helps us to increase the impact of research for public benefit, build a shared vision for the future of professionalization, of using technology in education, and thinking about growing our community of members. And a lot of the work I'm going to be sharing with you in the next couple of moments is really done by the community, and it's my privilege to share it with you, but it's very much a joint and community effort. So I wanted to move away from thinking about openness necessarily in an institutional context, but thinking of it more in terms of the broader picture as professionals in lots of different roles. How can we think about openness more usefully? And particularly where we're working in educational technology, I think it's very crucial when we think about data ethics or student well-being or some of the more tricky questions when we're thinking about implementing technology at scale. So that's why I think where we start when we think about open for whom is that we think, you know, open across all sectors of education. So if you're, whether you're a school teacher or a university professor or a researcher, we think there is a lot that we can learn from each other. So openly, particularly sharing policies around things like learning analytics or how we use different platforms, really helps us and encourage some open collaboration with industry, which is something that we really champion. And last year we published a guide, for example, together with startups on how to work together. And that was also an open collaboration. We also encourage individuals involved in our community to share within their institution. So if we think about the US context, I suppose to you, most of our institutions look tiny. And a lot of the people involved are on a much smaller scale. But there's still a lot of need to share across institution and across different faculty. So we use our network of members groups, which are open to everyone involved in the community, and also online events like this to help disseminate open education practice. But most of all, I wanted to highlight to you an accreditation framework that we've developed and that's been operating for the past 10 years. That's called CMOLD, which provides pathway for peer-assessed accreditation. And I've included some of the core principles of the scheme, which don't mention open education practice specifically, but are very much aligned to our sort of open ethos, which is a commitment to communicating and disseminating best practice and empathy and willingness to learn from colleagues, a commitment to exploring and understanding the interplay between learning and technology, and a commitment to keep up to date with new technologies. Now, last week, some of our members got together to discuss how we think educational technology is changing, how we think the landscape is changing. And I think we all came to the conclusion that open education is really helping us develop a more critical and a more nuanced approach to using educational technology. So if you'd like to follow up and see some examples of this in practice, maybe find some resources that you can use with your community in your context, have a look at this call to action that we published on open education and OER, which gives you a sort of, I suppose, a European and UK perspective on where we are policy-wise. It goes very much beyond the open textbook, open course, and thinks of open education as a broader concern. I also wanted to highlight to you the work of ALT's president, Martin Weller, who I'm sure many of you will be familiar with. He gave a really interesting inaugural lecture to celebrate 50 years of the Open University here in the UK on aspects of open, the evolution of the meaning of open education, which is a fantastic and really thought-provoking video. And I did want to give a shout out, and I put a resource as well on the Google Doc to Femme EdTech, which is a volunteer network, like a grassroots movement that I'm one of the volunteers of. And it's very much an open network. And we are looking into making a quilt that looks at social justice and open education. So if any of your craft craft challenged or craft enthusiasts. You can draw, you can computer print, you can digitally make something, you can knit, you can stitch, you can crochet, you can make stuff and contribute it to our quilt and help us bring open education, I suppose, into a material dimension. Open to all and welcome if you want to continue conversations with practitioners and researchers here in the UK. It's our Open Education Special Interest Group. So I hope that will be of interest to you. And last but not least, I wanted to highlight a new venture for us for next year where we're exploring the care in open education, specifically in London in April. And with that, I've come to the end. And thank you very much. I hope some of this has been of interest to you and that you'll find lots of resources to explore.
Oh, I see. This has been an abundance of riches. I am so delighted. Thank you, Maren. Thank you, Frank. We're going to turn it over to questions now so you can start to leave them in the chat and I'll be happy to amplify them so that we can hear from both of our speakers. But just a little bit of housekeeping, our task at hand, and I'm going to put actually a direct link to the particular section where we'll be working. So while we go through questions for our two speakers, the collaborative activity is posted here. Some of you have already started to write within the questions that we've left here. So please start to fill in this area with your thoughts, your ideas, and also under the contributors area as well, leave your name so that we can credit you for your fine work that you do today. So questions from folks, and I'll do the teacher pause, wait until we're we're uncomfortable and then
Angela.
Yes.
Yeah, perhaps there was one question about YouTube already in the stream. And I think YouTube was a very early place where people shared open videos and things like that. I know now I'm not sure because I talked with people from Fremtechnet, which is perhaps something different than what Maren mentioned, but they use Vimeo as a platform to share videos. The problem a little with YouTube is, of course, that it's a very closed medium. So it's a bit like the old MOOCs, where the professor stands on the on the platform speaking to his students, and somebody is filming it, and that's all you got. So yes, it's open, but I don't think it's necessarily a very good medium to share things with. On the other hand, when I started out with open education, I remember in higher ed journal article about when Pakistan shut down YouTube. There was a whole group of young girls who were trying to learn chemistry through these kinds of media. And well, if it's the only place you have to go to learn, then I think it's fine. But I hope I never get a doctor or a pharmacist who learned his trade on YouTube only.
That sort of begs the question of what would YouTube have to do such that you would have faith in the content and the knowledge that is there? Because I'm always asking the converse of what if.
It certainly didn't turn me into a plumber.
It didn't work out for Clark as a plumber. I have a question for both of you, and we'll start with Maren. In terms of the shift that we see within our field from really closely examining and focusing on open educational resources and opening that up to look at open educational practices, and really we're on the precipice of even changing practices to practitioners. So kind of moving into this conversation of people and the communities that are formed around openness. What do each of you see as really compelling initiatives or things that folks might engage in to better expand the definition of openness within their own regional contexts?
Oh, great question. Thank you, Angela. I'm just going to pick up on 2 points. I think for me, there is something about precarity. So many open education practitioners are in real, self-funded, precarious, kind of doing it for the love of it situations. And I think that's where bodies, like the community that I work with are so important to provide some continuity. You know, we don't provide money, but we do provide a long-term home, infrastructure, archives, so that it's not dependent on one individual. And I think that's really one of the things that I find is very systemic, at least here in Europe and in the UK, is that open projects often come and go when the funding goes. So one of the things we've done with the OER conference is to just give it a home regardless of that and kind of just give it some continuity. And that's really increased the impact. I think for me, one of the other things that we are championing here in the UK, where I think in the US you've kind of made more progress, is to get policymakers and, get law really involved in OE openness in general. Like, we're still campaigning for educational resources to be openly licensed as standard and sort of projects like that. So I think those would be the two things that I would pick out.
And, that last piece that you just mentioned too, Clark has been asking this of all of the speakers, so I'm going to let him interject with his question for the both of you. Yeah, which you sort of answered a little bit of that for us.
Right. And I like that the presentation also looked at policy and started to bring this up. But I guess what I'm curious about is that perspective of policy and law. And I feel like I've heard about certain countries where they've managed to move that through and they have federal level national laws about openness, about sharing things with Creative Commons licenses and OER and so on, especially when things are federally funded or grant funded and so on. So I may be mistaken. I thought maybe Portugal was a country, but do you know of countries in Europe where that's the case, that where that's actually happened? And I'm also curious, Maren, a little bit about how you're trying to move that needle.
Well, I'm sure Frank has thoughts on this as well, but just to jump in, I think France has made a lot more progress. So one of the things that I'm aware of via the Open Aperio Foundation is they're investing really heavily in sort of cross-institutional funding programs to fund open educational resources that can be shared widely. And it's a centrally funded, government-funded process. Here in the UK, we've made great progress adopting open access for research, but we're really, I think, lagging behind when it comes to open educational resources, textbooks, mandating that publicly funded resources should be openly licensed, which is our real aim. And we work closely with organizations like Creative Commons or the Open Education Consortium to try and really show, policymakers what the efficiency savings are, because I think, well, at least in my experience, policymakers are often most accessible when it comes to the bottom line, then maybe impact, and then, everything else comes to that. So I think our arguments are very much around trying to make sure that everything publicly funded is openly licensed and that we mandate that for the good of everyone.
Frank, what are your thoughts on these two topics?
Yeah, well, I'm not very familiar with the specific laws, but I know in, at least from my own experience and the people I talked, for example, in Germany, that there are, how do you say it, that there are real barriers for opening up. For example, when we were talking as Open University to free to open up our courseware, the Ministry of Education and the Minister of Education were very negative about it, because they the lobby of the publishers was very much involved in the talk about a level playing field, and they turned they turned it around. That now, for example, with research, we have the same policy as I think in the UK. What is paid by public money should be openly accessible. But when we tried to open up our educational materials, they said we had an advantage over the commercial publishers because we were funded, and they forbid us to open up educational materials which was funded by public funds, because the argument was the level playing field. And so also with our commercial education, we have a little bit of problem with that. I know in Germany, the Fernuniversität is not a major playing in the open movement, because they also have the same legal problems. Whereas I spoke with people in Tallinn, and well, the entrance to the regular programs is so open. You don't pay any fees for an official program. So they're not involved in openness as such, because their regular program is already open. So they don't feel a need for the legislation. I know we did a lot in the Netherlands, a lot on the Open Commons, but I'm not really, I don't know what the stance at this moment is, for example, for the policy makers. That there seems to be a little move away from the market, but in the past years, we had all always to tread very small, very slow, because of the publishers and other people. I don't know if that answers your question, but
well, I think it poses just the issue that Clark, in asking this question, is starting to reveal, and it reminds me of some of what Donjay Jury spoke about in his previous session, about how if we have practices in certain places, doesn't it behoove us to share those with everybody to make sure that we're all equitably approaching this in the right way. I think it also links to the conversation in the chat right now between Marin and Robin DeRosa and Nate also plus one, and I wanted to plus one that too about the precarity of openness. I particularly struggle with the issue that we don't create models that also give people, I don't even know how to say it, because there's no expectation of compensation or recognition perhaps, but maybe it's better to say we should be good to the people that are providers and are contributors to this community, because burnout is a real issue within organizational leadership around open. It's an issue, and there shouldn't be an expectation that only certain people have to carry the torch for all of us. Leadership should be distributed. This work should be shared. And when we talk about open, it needs to be built upon a framework that allows us to share that work. So when I hear the word precarity, I say yes, and I see it as how do we actually sustain the people beyond just the resources, but how do we sustain the people that are the pillars of these open communities? And that in and of itself is a social justice issue, I would say.
Yeah, and this touches on, you know, Robin is commenting about the core set of values around inclusion and acknowledging power. That comes into play as well, and kind of goes back to also something that Frank mentioned in his talk about involving students and the student voice. And that's another big piece of this.
And it's always ancillary, right? It's always a bolt-on of like, oh, and then we need to think about students. It's like, well, why are we here? I mean, isn't that what brought us all here? And then we're adding that at the end as if it's an afterthought. So go ahead, Marin.
I was just going to say, in the Google Doc, there is a question about, you know, how can you move the openness needle in your organization? And one of the things that this discussion really echoes for me is about vulnerability, both for professionals and for learners and everyone involved. I think, you know, there's so often an assumption that if someone has a loud voice or someone is visible, that they're somehow not vulnerable. And I think openness, open practice does create a sense of vulnerability in everyone. I'm sure you've all been there, you know, at the front of the lecture theater or in front of the workshop where everything kind of failed, or when you said the wrong thing online and there was an endless stream of comments. And I think that's something that for learners is really important to learn as part of their sort of digital development and critical literacy towards using technology, is that, you know, it is a vulnerable position and you are always going to need to learn and need support. So I think that's a really evocative piece of conversation for me that I'm going to take away and think about a bit more.
Well, I think that that's a compelling close. I don't want to end with any more other than that reflective piece of how are we going to be authentic, open, transparent, and how are we going to support each other in that work of doing it? Because it is difficult work, and we go out on a limb to do it. And both of our speakers today went out on a limb for cramming a lot of brilliance into a very short amount of time. So applause for them. Applause is coming. We're working on it. We're doing it over here. We'll have the weird sort of virtual Zoom applause for the folks that are on camera. I'm never happy with that. This was an amazing session. I will remind everybody that this document will continue to be open for folks to contribute to. And again, if you have folks that you can connect with that would really benefit from this particular worksheet that we're collaborating on together, either learning from it or adding to it, or ideally both, please invite them to join us. Our next session, it will start at 1 p.m., but what I'm gonna do for the rest of this time is turn it over to my dear friend and colleague, Nate Angel, who's gonna talk a little bit about open annotation and the ways that we can extend these provocations that we started working on today with the resources that our speakers shared. And we're working out a day and a time to have a gathering, an open annotation gathering of sorts, to a reunion, if you will, of all of the goodness from today, for us to work on that together. So, repeating the information about the virtual escape room. So today's work on the Online International Summit is one day of 4 days of programming as part of OLC Live. And Clark Shaw Nelson and myself, we're your hosts in all of that. So OLC Live for the next 3 days, we'll be talking about the future of education. We will be joining you from a space station in the year 2525. And as part of that, we have a series of interviews with amazing speakers. We have a couple of games, including a design battle that will be happening tomorrow, where different teams from different institutions will have a challenge that Nate has crafted for them, and an open rubric that will be used to judge their work. But on Thursday, we actually have an escape. It's a completely online virtual escape room that has been built. Oh, Clark put design work over here right now. The computer is hot as he's getting the schedule ready for you. So that escape room is from 3:45 to 4:45. However, if you want to try to escape, you have to enter the room before 4:20, because otherwise you will not have enough time to escape. You only get 20 minutes to get up to the space station where Clark and I are before a transport pod launches you, and you need to secure a package that will help us. We're truly in peril. We will be in peril on Thursday, so it's of utmost importance that you escape quickly with the goods that we need in order to survive. So Clark just put the whole OLC Live schedule up there. We'll leave that up for a little bit so that you can see. And I really welcome you to come to any and all of these events. They're open to everybody. We really want to inspire the conversations that we've been having throughout the day today, throughout the entire week and beyond. So without any further ado, I will turn it over to Nate Angel.
Hey, folks, thanks for that, Angela. And I'll just be really quick here. I just put a link above in the chat for anybody who's not familiar with the open source web-based collaborative annotation tool Hypothesis. You can create a free account and join in annotating some of the rich documents that Frank and Marin have shared with us. And you'll see in the Google Doc that we've been collaborating in all of the recommended readings and resources that Frank and Marin have suggested have links with annotation added to them. You can follow those links and see any annotations that have been added so far. And if you have a Hypothesis account, also add your own annotations or reply to other people's annotations. And so as the rest of the week goes on, we'll be annotating documents as we go along. And as Angela suggested, we're thinking about working on making an event that would specifically just be devoted to annotating documents that have been shared in this international summit that's going on all day today. I'll be around if anybody has any questions about annotation all day in the room, so feel free to reach out to me, or my contact information is in the Google Doc.
And definitely take advantage of Nate's expert help. He's a gentleman and a scholar, and appreciate his time so much. And appreciate the time of our two speakers, Marin and Frank. A heart for you, a heart for you. And we'll bid everybody adieu until our next session, which starts promptly at 1 p.m. Eastern time. We'll be heading off to South America. We're really racking up some good frequent flyer miles today. Oh, man. The jet lag is, it hasn't even hit him. It'll kick in at some point. So, all right. Take care, everybody. We'll see you in a bit.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great rest of the day. Pleasure to see you all.
Thanks.
Take care. Thank you, Marin.